Boris Yeltsin, the politician most well known to be part of the dissolution of the USSR, was elected president of Russia in 1991 after the first presidential elections in the country while it was still under the Soviet banner.
Президентские выборы состоялись.
Soon after these elections, communist hardliners believed that the late Mikhail Gorbachev, the final leader of the Soviet Union, was the reason that the Union was falling apart, and orchestrated what is now known as the August coup. Watch my previous video if you want more information on that. On August 21st, the State Committee on the State of Emergency was dissolved, and Yeltsin by then had essentially used the power vacuum left behind to consolidate Russia as a completely autonomous state from the Soviet Union. Ending the August coup, Yeltsin was represented as a defender of democracy across Russia. This led to links with him and United States President Bill Clinton. However, Clinton's advisors were skeptical of Yeltsin. Keep this in mind for later. Gorbachev no longer had any power, as Soviet republics had started declaring left and right, partially due to the instability created after the State Committee on the State of Emergency. Approximately 4 months later, on December 8th, leaders of the three countries of Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus met to officially dissolve the USSR. The Russian Federation was officially declared on December 12, 1991. On December 25th, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics was legally no more, being disbanded by the final leader, Mikhail Gorbachev. Not even 2 years later, and Russia was going through a constitutional crisis. From October 3rd to 4th, 1993, Boris Yeltsin began an armed insurgency against the legislature of Russia. This all almost culminated in a civil war, though luckily the conflict de-escalated. This all built up from a rivalry between two powerful men, the ethnically Chechen Supreme Soviet Chairman Ruslan Khasbulatov and the Russian President Boris Yeltsin. Although they were formerly good allies before the Soviet Union dissolved, the two became enemies. In September, Khasbulatov began to denounce Yeltsin. One of his main talking points was Yeltsin's alcohol addiction. He led many lawmakers to assist him in impeaching Yeltsin, which of course Yeltsin didn't listen to. Justification was that Yeltsin had issued an unconstitutional decree on September 21st when he attempted to dissolve parliament and that he was planning to consolidate control under himself. For the last few months prior to the crisis, Yeltsin had been trying to consolidate all power under his control, essentially trying to set up a rule by decree where the executive branch has all power. The legislators hid in the Russian White House. In response, Yeltsin cut off important infrastructure such as electricity and water. Soon, fights broke out in the civilian populace. On October 3rd, there were major escalations. Anti-Yeltsin protests sprouted out across Moscow, resulting in them attempting to take the mayor's office and the center of Russian media, Ostankino Tower. Supporters of parliament seized the Moscow municipal government building. These supporters were mostly comprised of communists and nationalists, not the nicest people. After all, Yeltsin was the one who took down the communist Soviet Union and was trying to install a federative democratic republic in Russia. Might have gone on some radicals' nerves. These protesters would end up clashing with the riot police. As a result, Yeltsin declared a state of emergency. He ordered his defense minister at the time, Pavel Grachev, to show the White House. The Russian Orthodox Church tried to organize a compromise between Yeltsin and the legislature, though this would end up going nowhere and the fight would prolong. After the Russian army shelled the White House, they stormed the building. They cleared every floor one by one and captured the parliament. After the events of the constitutional crisis, order was restored, though sniper fire still occurred throughout the day. Yeltsin began a three-month-long campaign to essentially give the president almost all power. He arrested the Supreme Soviet legislatures and replaced them with his new Federal Assembly of Russia, composed of the Federation Council, the Upper House, and State Duma, Lower House. Both Khasbulatov and Yeltsin's former vice president, Alexander Rutskoy, were arrested. The same day, the vice president's office was abolished, resulting in the prime minister's office becoming the second most powerful. Though, a year later, all persecuted would be pardoned by the Duma. The government of Russia reports that approximately 200 people had been killed and 500 were wounded. According to Radio Free Europe, this was the worst violence in Moscow since the 1917 Bolshevik coup. Yeltsin's new constitution would be voted in on December 12, 1993. To delve a bit deeper into the roles of everyone in the story, we will start with Ruslan Khasbulatov. The speaker was of Chechen origin and was an economist. He was originally one of Yeltsin's allies during the collapse of the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, though we know how that would end up. He even backed Yeltsin when in conflict with the State Committee on the State of Emergency. The reason that he had severed ties with Yeltsin was because of their policy differences, with the most prominent ones being Yeltsin's idea of shock therapy in a market economy, the idea that drastic changes would make the economy more capitalist. He would publicly denounce Yeltsin as an irresponsible alcoholic. During the 1993 crisis, he and other lawmakers would appoint the vice president, Alexander Rutskoy, as the president. Speaking of Alexander Rutskoy, the former vice president was a decorated Soviet war veteran fighting in Afghanistan. Just like with Khasbulatov, he was one of Yeltsin's closest allies during the 91 coup, even being chosen as the vice president of Russia. Starting in 1992, the two had their fallout, with Rutskoy critiquing Yeltsin, and especially Yeltsin's economists, such as Yegor Gaidar and Anatoly Chubais. In September of 1993, when the crisis would begin, Yeltsin kicked Rutskoy out of his Kremlin office, forcing Rutskoy to move into the parliament, where he would spend his final days in office. He was sworn in as acting president by the parliament when Yeltsin dissolved parliament. Yeltsin's prime minister was Yegor Gaidar, one of the aforementioned economists. As mentioned, he enacted a policy referred to as shock therapy. It was a type of rapid economic liberalization, and it would result in a divide in Russia. Parliament would continuously attempt to deny him as a prime minister, likely widening the gap between parliament and the president. During the constitutional crisis, Gaidar attempted to talk to the people of Russia and told them to protest the parliament, and even claimed that if the parliament won this conflict, that Russia would quote-unquote be turned into an enormous concentration camp for decades. Funnily enough, although he spent these last few years trying to achieve power in the Russian government and implement his policies, he would end up retiring in 1994 and returning to academics. Another one of Yeltsin's compatriots was the aforementioned Pavel Grachev, Yeltsin's defense minister. Like the others, he was one of Yeltsin's greatest supporters during the 1991 August coup. Though unlike the others, he kept his position and would become a very important role in overthrowing the parliament. He organized the shelling and storming of the White House and was decorated after the crisis. His reputation ended up suffering after corruption charges were brought up and he was given the nickname Pasha Mercedes. Viktor Yelin was Russia's interior minister. And like Pavel Grachev, he was a Yeltsin loyalist and an important figure in the crisis. After the events, he was decorated with the award Hero of the Russian Federation. Similar to Grachev, he had to resign not long after, just for a different reason. This reason was his failure to rescue Russian hostages held by Chechen militias. Yeltsin's bodyguard, Alexander Kozhikov, is believed to be one of the main influences for how Yeltsin's coup went down. Some report that he was the one that told Yeltsin and Grachev to shell the White House. Kozhikov himself published a memoir in 1997 that would uncover many of Yeltsin's illicit actions. After the events of October 4th, Clinton's administration decided to support Yeltsin no matter what. At this point, there were no good alternatives. According to declassified documents, Bill Clinton and his staff ended up praising Yeltsin and would call him the next day. Clinton's Secretary of State, Warren Christopher, would applaud Yeltsin and praise him on his quote-unquote superb handling of the matter. Some ambassadors stated that after the crisis, the United States' only choice was to support Yeltsin and his government. Looking at this, the 1993 constitutional crisis was an obvious misuse of power to promote totalitarianism, which would lead Russia into its current stance as one of the most authoritarian states in the modern world under the regime of Vladimir Putin. Подмосковные вечера. Phew. Let's hope that's the biggest crisis of my presidency. It was not.